Starting. There we go. We are live, looks like. Yep.
All right.
So this is part two of creating a film directing course for beginners. And this is Mike Swantek. I'm going to click on him right now. There he is. Say hi, Mike. Mike Swantek is award-winning editor. And this is me, John Hulser, and I'm director at the Digital Film Farm. And I wanted to be real transparent with this process and how we're going about, you know, creating this first course. So that's why we're doing a Google Hangout. So if you stumbled upon this, there is a part one. We'll put a link into that. And we're going to review a document that I started off creating with bullet points and an idea that I wanted to answer a bunch of filmmaker questions. Beginning filmmaker questions. I passed it on to Mike and I said, Mike, you're a filmmaker, you're an editor, you're a writer, can you fill it in? And so that's what he's been doing, and we are at module 1.4, and he's going to fill us in on where we're going to go from here. This is the skeleton for the course that I'm going to do by answering questions on camera, and then also bringing in B-roll to that. So, actually, Mike, can you take it over from here, please?
Sure. So, as you said, John, we left off last time at module 1.4, and basically that was starting the discussion of the two different approaches that a starting film director, would kind of take. One is a more fun approach, and one is a more serious approach. So 1.4 is discussing the 1.4 approach, the fun approach. So basically what we've kind of decided is if someone wants to approach filmmaking at a fun approach.
Hey Mike, will your cursor point up to the more fun approach, the cell in there? I don't know if we're going to be able to see it or not.
Yep.
But I wonder if we can. I guess we can't see it. Okay, never mind. That's all right. We can tell. Maybe mine will see it. Oh yeah, I think it does. So this is the more fun approach right here that I'm pointing to.
Yeah.
The bullet points, and
then let me make. You know what I think questions. Is happening? All right. Hold on a second.
Bear with us, folks. We are.
There you go. So that's filling the screen. So you're seeing all five columns, correct?
I am seeing. They're small, so it was nicer actually to see them a little bigger.
But then you were. All right. How about this?
Maybe we can find a compromise.
Okay. That's
so while you're doing that, I'm going to let folks know that we've got the module, the general theme, and which in this case there's nothing in here, and then bullet points. These are the points that I want to make questions, and then the prompt questions that the interviewee, probably Joe Grieco, will be asking me, and we will later fill this in with additional B-roll. So that's something that Joe and I are going to do on this end.
So basically, this module is going to address that if someone wants to start making a film from a fun approach, there are a few things that you could do quickly and easily to just dive in. So one is make three short films fast. Wing it. Don't worry too much about pre-production. Shoot it with your iPhone if you want to. And then also be aware that if you're tackling your fun approach to film quickly, you may wear multiple hats. You might wear the producer's hat, you might wear the cinematographer's hat, you might wear the grip hat, but try to identify when you are playing multiple roles, when you are wearing multiple hats.
Let's take a look at you on camera, Mike. I think we've seen this document enough.
Sure.
Sorry, the director of me coming out.
I was just going to go through the prompt questions and come back to me.
Okay, sorry.
So some of the questions that Joe could ask you for this module are, what are some of the initial things a beginning film director who is approaching filmmaking from a fun perspective can do to get started? And is it okay to wear multiple hats?
Great. And so I think we want to make sure that we recognize that there are a lot of people, you know, making films for fun, and that this is there is an approach that we can go through to make it even more fun and to go down that path. So I don't want to ignore that that type of filmmaking, and that's why we want to make sure we have this module here. But I also think it's a good time because we're going to start to go off in two different directions, a more serious approach, and then every once in a while we will reference, you know, the more fun approach. So this is going to be that point where we start to divert. Is that correct, Mike?
Yeah, that's exactly what I was thinking. Yep.
All right. So what's next?
All right, so module 1.5 is starting to address that budding film director, if he's going to or she is going to be approaching it from a more serious approach. So that entails maybe you should adapt the fun approach to your first film. Dive in, wing it. Don't spend a lot of time on pre-production. You know, make a 3-4 minute film, kind of figure things out. But then on your second film, you may want to get a little bit more serious, work from an outline, and kind of figure out what you really want to say. It's kind of that beginning, planting that seed of trying to find your voice as a director. I would strongly suggest that we make them short, you know, under 10 minutes. I think this will be a great lesson.
Making what short? The each module, or you're talking about the people's films?
Films.
Well, there you go. I see it right there. Under 10 minutes. Gotcha.
Yep. Keep the films under 10 minutes. And there's a couple reasons for that we will address in this module, and I think we'll just address throughout the entire lesson. So one of the things that keeping them under 10 minutes will do is, let's say you have 20 or 30 minute story. I think forcing yourself to keep them under 10 minutes, I think you'll start to realize what efficient filmmaking is, and trying to, you know, never say anything that can be shown and all that stuff. I think
Right. Let's pop back and forth to your face a little bit more, Mike. I think it's actually kind of boring sitting here watching this this document too much.
Okay.
If it's easy, is it easy enough to do that? I mean, just keep popping back and forth.
Oh, everything is simple.
Everything's easy.
It's easy. So, and then the other thing, if you're going to approach it from a more serious point of view, I think in this module we would also like to address not just surrounding yourself with family and friends, but really start to try to seek out like-minded collaborators. You know, ones that are really strong in cinematography, or ones that are really strong in producing or writing. And this will, again, will kind of, you'll get more familiar with the process right off the bat, of just the whole idea of everyone wearing different hats. So, and then there were some tidbits I added of examples of good short films that do really embrace efficient, stylized short filmmaking, like Scorsese's first one, which is called The Big Shave. It runs 6 minutes, perfect. Any longer, it would be too long. Any shorter, be too short. 6 minute film, gets the point across, perfect. And then the other reason why, if you really are going to approach this from a serious point of view, where you really, like, let's say you have dreams of getting into a film festival, keeping them short, under 10 minutes, allows the festivals to program them a lot easier than, let's say, your short film is 30 minutes long or 35 minutes long.
So important, yeah.
So because, you know, they basically piggyback them onto the features that have been selected for the film. So, like, if, you know, they have a two-hour block and the feature's an hour and 50 minutes, if you have an 8-minute short, you're more likely to get it programmed into that festival and accepted into that festival if it's shorter. So
Right. So it sounds like this module right here is about starting to look at how that serious filmmaker can start to build their foundation. And I mean, you mentioned we're going to introduce building your team around you, or starting to work from a collaborative point of view and introducing that, and also looking at filmmaking and the structure of filmmaking, as opposed to just making a film that is, I think, in the beginning, it's important that a filmmaker looks at approaching this from where do I want to go point of view. And I think what you're describing and looking at, you know, how is this short film going to help me take that next step, you know, as someone who wants to get something out of, you know, my filmmaking other than just having fun with my friends. So we are looking, and I think that's one of the names we've been thinking of calling this is First Steps. And I think that that's appropriate, and especially in this situation, that we're looking at what are some of those first steps from a business point of view, but also from an operational point of view, pre-production, on-set, and in post-production, which I know you're going to be getting to moving forward.
Yeah, and again, I didn't know how long you wanted this module to be, but there is a whole second page to this module that just kind of elaborates a little bit on what you were just saying, and also on just, again, the whole idea of starting to think about. So if you're approaching it from a serious point of view, here, let me just call up that document and just show you the second page really yep. quick. If you're approaching it from a serious point of view, the other thing that you really want to start thinking about is compiling your reel. And in filmmaking, you know, your reel is your portfolio or your resume. So as you make an 8-minute short film, a 12-minute short film, a 6-minute short film, you'll start to build your reel. And a good reel can open doors. And to that point that you made the other day, the other thing that's really good is as you get better as a director, you'll begin to attract better talent across all the different disciplines. You know, a better DP, a better producer, you know, they'll be more willing to work with a skilled director. So that reel can really open up doors, not just to find like an audience for your film or a way to distribute your film, but also will help you find the talent to make your next film better.
Right.
So those are all the different... Yeah, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
Well, no, it's just those are all the things that I think it's not too early to start thinking about if you are going to approach it as a serious filmmaker or a director as opposed to someone who's just out to have fun, which is, there's nothing wrong with that.
It's important to know that if you're going to become if you're going to make any marks in the filmmaking world and even online filmmaking, you got to build a team. You know, that's something that is essential, and that's something that you're bringing up right now. So I have a question for you, and I want to do this as just an overview point. So as you're describing this, you know, we're talking about this is the module right now where we're looking at becoming a filmmaker with a plan, with a desire, with expectations. You know, so that's just a different way of saying, you know, we're getting serious about our craft here. Let's take a quick look back and ask ourselves the question, why wouldn't we start the whole thing right here and not do any of the modules before? And I can't even remember what the modules that we had before were, but I'm wondering, why not jump in right here?
Because I think the few modules that happened before are addressing, you know, before you get to the fork in the road, I think you need to just get on the road. So I think
Can you read those through real quick and just maybe do a one sentence on what they're about?
Sure.
I don't even care if I'm on the screen, but whatever.
Yeah, module 1.0 is everyone can direct. So it's addressing, obviously, if you're coming to this lesson, you have an interest in film directing. So it doesn't matter what the reason is. Most of the old excuses of why you can't do it are kind of out the window because everything's more affordable.
Let's look at this from the point of view of everyone can direct. So from an emotional point of view, this is supposed to encourage them. So we want to encourage the new filmmaker.
Yep.
So I'm justifying that module. What's our next module?
So the next module is, so if you do want to be a filmmaker, do you take a lesson like this, or do you go to film school? So that's 1.1, which is to go or not to go. So you've addressed... So
how do we justify this module?
Because you've addressed that you can make a film, so then the questions are, what is the right path to making that film? Do you go out?
And I totally agree with you, but here's something I'm not gonna worry about answering it right now. Mm-hmm. But this really starts to look at whether we're getting serious about it or not, because the independent or the fun filmmaker is not going to go to film school. Would you agree with that?
That's a valid point. Yeah.
So all I want to say is I just want to flag this module and say, is this the right place for it, or do we put this film school question within the getting serious part of it?
Yeah, or it's a subheader off of the serious filmmaker module. Right. Yeah, no, I can see that. I can totally see that. If we want to build the matrix, yeah, I can see that. So maybe you bump. Now, yeah.
Okay, what's our next one?
So the next one is, the next one is 1-2, which is, what do you want from filmmaking right now? So this is planting that seed of fun or serious.
Do you want? Okay, so this is, okay, so at this point, we're justifying this because I believe that it's absolutely important for anyone that's going forward with anything, but especially something like filmmaking or creating, that they take ownership of it. Before we can make a good decision about what to do, we have to understand, we have to go inside of ourselves and say, why do I want this? What am I trying to get out of this? What do I want out of this? And so so this is what you're addressing here. Why do we want?
Yeah, so I think so I think that definitely plants a seed of starting to think about the fun or serious. So I still think that stays in place before we branch off. The next one does get detailed. That's the talking about the tripod of production.
Tripod, right. So the tripod of production, as we said, is the direct, looking at the director, the cinematographer, and the producer. Did I do that? Something like that. Tripod. And the producer as a team that comes together, because all of our departments work off of that initial tripod. And if you have three people that can work together, those would be the first three people that you could maximize their efforts and move forward. So we definitely can justify this one. And this is the first step, or maybe not the first step, but this is a first step in becoming a serious... Well, you know what? This is a first step, I believe, whether you're just having fun
well,
or
that's
serious.
Here, let me call up the module again. Let me just show you. I did address that. I said, okay, before you decide which path is your path, you know, the fun path versus the serious path, you should quickly become familiar with the different hats worn during the production stage of the making of your film. So I think, I do think you have to address the roles before you decide which way you want to go.
Yep. So. Okay. So totally justified there. Why? So we're looking at everyone can direct, whether or not people should go to film schools, what do you want out of being a filmmaker, and then the tripod, you know, this is the core foundation, whether you're going to go serious or you just want to have more fun.
Right.
As long as you don't want to be a loser, then, you know, I shouldn't say loser, but... I have some strong feelings about working with a team. You know, I think everybody can do it on their own, and there's a lot to be said for wearing, you know, different hats when you have to. But I'll tell you what, when it comes to moving forward, man, there's nothing like a team.
Absolutely. Like-minded. You can find talented people, but you have to have people that are on the same page or at least in the same chapter. But I think if you find the right team, it can only make your film better.
Absolutely. I definitely have. I'm glad you said that because that's important. All right, so where we go after that? So that's,
but you did sell me. You did sell me. You brought it up. You did sell me. I would definitely move the film school discussion under the more serious approach discussion.
All right. Is that what comes after the tripod? No, more fun comes after that, right?
Right, more fun than more serious. So taking module 1.1, which was to go or not to go, I would move it underneath 1.5, which is the more serious approach.
Yep. I have a suggestion. What if we took the more fun approach and we moved it up in front of why do you want to be a filmmaker, where film school was, so that we go from everybody can direct, And then we talk about the fun of filmmaking. We stay with the fun. And then right after it's the fun, because that's where most people start, we go into why do you want to be a filmmaker? And at that point we start to address, you know, because what I'm going to try, the point that I'm going to make is that if you have expectations that are of a certain sort, then there is one path, and that is to start to become more serious about your practice.
Yeah. The only thing that I like about the discussion of the tripod is what we just said. It introduces people, whether you want to do it for fun or for serious, it introduces people to the different roles on set. That's the only thing that gets a little tricky there with that new flow that's proposed.
So what you're saying, if I hear you correctly, is if we do move the more fun one up above, why do you want to be a filmmaker and the tripod approach, that, and then now I lost my thought here, that it actually messes up the tripod module a little bit?
Yeah. Well, I mean, those can be juggled. Clearly, there's reason for. I definitely am sold on moving.
We don't have to decide right now. But let's take a look at that. Because the tripod approach is, I think, what we were saying before was that it could be used by the more fun or the more serious filmmaker, and. And so we certainly would not want to move the more fun approach before it, if in fact it diluted, you know, that that statement or anything else we wanted to make. So I agree that we should look at it and look at it from that point of view.
Is your concern that your reasoning behind maybe moving some things around, is your concern that we're not addressing the director who wants to approach it from a fun perspective to...
No. Okay. No, my concern, it's not a concern, actually. If just feels to me that the segue going from everybody can direct right into the most obvious of, you know, the fun parts of filmmaking, and that I just think that's where people start. And they start with, I call it pizza and beer filmmaking, and addressing, you know, making three films fast and looking at that so that we don't necessarily have to even backtrack when we talk about the serious filmmaker starting out, because we've already said, hey, this is how we're starting out. And if you're just getting started, have fun, man. Have some friends. Have some, you know, take this approach. But when it's time to get serious, let's now start to create a clear break in these two paths.
I can see that, and maybe we can shoehorn in the tripod discussion in between. We have everyone can direct. We move film school for now. We go everyone can direct to what do you want from filmmaking to fun approach. Then you go fun approach into maybe the tripod, and then go into serious, and then go into if you are taking this seriously, should you go to film school or not? That might...
Again, I don't think you have to decide on this, but why would you put more fun after what do you want from filmmaking? And I think maybe the statement that I believe is that everybody starts out, 99% of the people start out filmmaking from wanting to have fun, and that's going to be the first step always. And so I would think that would want to go before you start to do a... I don't need self-reflection if I just want to have fun. I just want to have fun, and I thought it would be cool to make films. I need self-reflection if, in fact, I find this is fun and I want to get more serious about it.
I just think, all right, so just to play devil's advocate.
Sure.
I just called this up. I'm going to take it off screen, but I called this up on screen just to show you. It's a very quick one. It's a very brief one. It's not as long as some of the other modules. And I just think it would...
Okay.
You know, what you have to ask yourself is, I started making movies when I was 8 years old, okay? So you have to ask yourself, is the 8-year-old going to start looking at this course and start for that, you know, that first one where almost 99% of people, they grab their camera and they do a really bad horror movie. That's what I did. So I think is it going to be that 8-year-old that has never touched a camera and gotten their friends, or is it going to be that 18-year-old
yep.
who has done 12 years of fun filmmaking and then now is like, do I still want to just make these for fun and actually learn a little bit on how to do it, or do I want to take the serious approach? So that's why I just think...
Okay. I think you might be selling me here. I think, so what you're saying is maybe introduce the fact that as you move forward over these next couple of modules, know that there is going to be a, you know, there's a difference. You know, what, and a difference comes from paying attention to what do you want from filmmaking. So then visiting the fun approach and then segueing into the tripod and then segueing into the serious, because we started off letting them know that it was all about them getting in touch with their expectations. So I think you're selling me on that.
Yeah, and again, it's really close. I think we're picking nits. You know, I think it's very close. So I think
Well, I think you're right, but from a delivery point of view, as the person that, you know, is going to be delivering this message, I think it's been a good thrashing process for me because I'm really getting anchored in seeing and getting, you know, in touch with that beginner filmmaker and who I'm talking to here. So, yeah, you're right. We can change it in the edit, and but I'm getting some valuable insights from it, so thanks.
And like I said, I think some of them are going to be really brief. Some of them are going to be really short, and some of them are going to be, you know, 6, 7, 8 minutes long, and some are going to be 1 to 2 minutes long. So I don't think it will ruin the flow too much, and you could even maybe wrap the discussion. Maybe the fun starts off with just a discussion of what you want from filmmaking and then go right into the fun, and it all becomes like kind of one module. So it's not a, you know, a separate standalone.
It'll be interesting to see how we do that. Yep. Okay, cool. Let's move forward.
So then the only other thing, one other point on module 1.5, let me just make sure that it is 1.5. Yeah, 1.5 is maybe the film director who wants the more serious approach is coming to this and they've written, maybe they've done 10 years of screenwriting. So maybe they have a few feature-length scripts, you know, in their pocket already. So one of the things I address really quickly is, let's say you want to, this is your first film, but you want to take a more serious approach. So one of the things I suggest is, as opposed to doing a short, which has a beginning, middle, and end, look at one of your scripts, see if you can pull out a section, you know, that kind of stands alone on its, you know, stands on its own.
Can I just interrupt you? Just anchor. So now I think I'm on. So what you're saying is that you're steering them toward making a short, even if there's someone who has done written a bunch of features and not, you know, that there's the other approach would be to pull a section out of their
correct
feature and make a short out of it. Okay, I got
correct.
You.
Yeah, and there's two examples that have done that well. Sling Blade started as he pulled a little section out, and then last year's Whiplash did the same thing. And Whiplash was actually used, it won the short film festival, or short film competition at the Sundance Festival, and then that's how he got his funding to make the feature. So,
right.
So that's it. Perfect. So in terms of that. So,
and what's that module, and so... Let me just get straight here. So we move on to, after more, the way it was laid out, after tripod and more fun, it's more serious. And that... And
then there's one... Was, go for it.
Nope, go ahead. I'm just orienting myself.
Yeah, then there's one last one that kind of can get grouped into that whole first kind of grouping of modules, and that's just... 1.6 overview of the course modules. So moving forward, what are the more details that first-time film director is going to learn from this course? So that's kind of an overview of a brief overview of the modules coming up. We will highlight when we are looking at more serious as opposed to the more fun approach.
I gotcha. Yep.
All right, and then obviously pre-production, post-production, or pre-production, production, post-production, and what I like to call the post-post-production, which is actually getting that film scene, and just kind of quickly doing an overview.
Okay, so we're going to – can you put that back up, Mike? Sorry about that. So what we're going to do is we're going to – so at this point in time, we're going to take a few minutes to let them know what's going to happen when we're moving forward. That's a great idea. I want to keep coming back to why we're doing it. I think, you know, anybody that's stumbling on this from a learning point of view, and also for anchoring myself, one of the important things I think is to know why are we doing this? Why do we think this is a good idea for the filmmaker? And so I think giving them, anchoring them in where they're going to be going is right on the money, so I agree.
Okay.
Can we look back just for a second so I can get oriented? As to, I don't want to get into detail. I just want the 30,000 foot view. We left off at tripod, and then more fun. And I want to just look at what happened in between there. So you can just scroll back, and we can look at this and get anchored in it.
Let me.
I got you.
So you got tripod.
We kept this as underneath module one, but we broke them out as 1.2, 1.3, that type of thing. Got you. So the production tripod is 1.3, okay? And then...
then you go into...
go ahead.
Fun approach, serious approach.
Yep.
And then just an overview of what you're going to learn in the following modules.
Just gotcha.
And then also, this will be the first time we kind of talked about... we kind of talked about the production tripod, which are the three key principal members of your crew during production. But also, we really haven't up to this point talked about pre-production in any way, post-production in any way, and post-post-production selling your film in any way. So I think it would be good, before we move on, to just kind of introduce those different stages of film directing.
Agreed. Okay, cool.
All right, so that ends kind of that one whole chunk of the ones, of 1.1 through 1.6. And then... so then we move on.
Equipment. All right, So why are we, and I'm not saying it from the point of view that I don't agree with it, but why are we showing equipment to film directors? What do we want to say about it that's important to film directors?
Well, the 2.0, let's hold that discussion for a second, because 2.0 is just kind of a brief, I see it as 1 or 2 minutes of an introduction of just like some of the things that you may want to look at as a film director.
But
then we, as you'll see, we break it down even in more detail for each of the four stages of film making. So
equipment for pre-production. Okay.
Okay. Gotcha. So 2.0 is just introducing, you know, some of the things you may need. And what I say in the overall theme is that there's affordable hardware or gear and software available for each stage. And that a budding director should be familiar with the tools available, even if you don't plan on using them.
Okay. You know? All right. So let's see you here, Mike. So tell me. Let me say what I think. So what we want to do is we want to let people know that, you know, because I want to keep bringing this back to why it's important to the beginning filmmaker or the beginning director. And so what I see now that you said that is that someone who's getting more serious needs to know what tools that they will be working with. And so this is going to be the time to just introduce them as an overview to those tools, correct?
Yeah.
All right. Okay, I got it. I'm with you.
All right.
Where we go? Now we're going into detail next, it seems, with the pre-production tools.
For the possible software or possible equipment that you will need as a first-time director, And again, these are just suggestions, and these are just things that I threw down there. So,
all right, so I'm just putting myself in the mindset of these guys taking the course. So I've just learned about directing is fun, and directing can be serious, and the tripod approach. And now, if I'm sticking with this, and tell me if you don't agree with me, if I'm sticking with this at this point, I, John Holzer, am making the assumption that these people sticking with it are the ones that want to be more serious about production. And that is why they're still with us. Would you agree with that?
I'd agree, yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
All right, so that at that point, you've got 2.1 equipment for pre-production. So tell me why this is important to the film director.
Before we move on, there is one thing I did want to say, and it's something that was kind of going through my head as I was laying this out, is I'm not trying to sell the director who wants to just approach it from a fun to transition to serious, but maybe a lot of the students coming to this course that just want to do the fun may, as they go through and learn some of this stuff, they might go, oh, that's not as overwhelming as I thought. Maybe I do want to approach it in the serious way or a little bit more serious.
So you know? If I'm hearing you right, what you're saying is that maybe I'm wrong in that assumption that only people who have made the decision, conscious decision, about being more serious about being a film director, a filmmaker, are watching this. You're saying that we still might have some of these people who are just exploring and maybe they're going to come along later?
I believe so. I think if you lay it out in the way that I envision it and the way that you described it to me, I think if you lay it out, I think you as an overview, I think it kind of it opens you up to realize that directing, especially today, 2015, is accessible, and I can get a little bit more serious about my craft because things are a lot more accessible and a lot easier to do. You know, you don't just have to make a fun film with your friends on the weekend over pizza and beer. You know, you can pick up these little nuggets, and yeah. I think if we lay them out in the right way, we could convert some people that want to do it for fun.
Yeah, I agree.
To do it a little bit more seriously. That's all.
I think that layout, I think what as you're saying it, I think what it probably needs to have is we need to be able to transition or clearly communicate that even having more fun, you can even have more fun when you work within this kind of a structure. When you bring in team members, when you bring in, it doesn't have to be that you are going, and maybe this is where, you know, I needed a kind of a check, and that is, being serious doesn't necessarily mean that the only deviation of approach from more fun isn't just going to Hollywood or going all the way in,
right.
You know, big screen, that there's a lot of other stuff that can happen in between, and some of it isn't, quote, rocket science. It can be somewhat easy if you take this approach, and we're going to share that approach with them. So I'm agreeing with you there. Yep.
Okay. So again, this is just some of the equipment. It's more software-based. This is some of the equipment that someone who's a first-time director may use. So one thing right off the bat, a lot of times at this level, you're probably going to be working from your own script. So you might want to look at a script writing software. So that's why I introduced Final Draft and why Final Draft is good. But I also introduced the alternatives. If you can't afford Final Draft, you can use your word processing software. You can use an old typewriter, or you can use paper and pen. You know, it doesn't matter. Just you have to get that. You know, everyone has a script in their heads. So I think it's just important to get it down on paper no matter what you do. Spreadsheets are really crucial. Sometimes more for the producer than for yourself, but if you're going to be wearing multiple hats, especially if you're a fun, you know, if you're approaching it from a fun aspect, you know, Excel is great at just laying it out, helping you come up with your schedule, coming up with your call lists, you know, and all that stuff. So And then, of course, in pre-production, the other thing that you're going to want to look at are some of the crowdfunding sites if you want to go in that direction. So, oh, and then the one other.
Let's get back on you, Mike.
Sorry. Sure. Just really quick, before I do that, before you see my smiling face, the one other tool that's good during pre-production is there are great resources online to help you find casting. And there are as many or more actors that are hungry than there are hungry directors. So there are a lot of people maybe willing to work for free.
Gotcha. So let me again anchor myself in this. So we've gone from the more serious overview, and we started to introduce, you did an overview of tools, and now you're getting deeper into tools. Some of the tools you're describing are screenwriting tools, casting tools, and cameras and stuff like that.
Cameras not yet. Cameras okay. Are going to be for production, not for pre-production.
I'll tell you, I'm feeling like I might drop this stuff, and here's why. What I've happened to me before, and I know it's very easy to do, is we get and maybe not. You know, I have to look at what this course is. If this is a course that is designed to give the beginning filmmaker a path to being able to get on set, to take their idea, to get on set and to move forward, I don't know. I guess there's something about, I don't want to get too bogged down in tools on it, but I don't know that I'm making any sense right now.
If you want to lose it, you can totally lose it. I just, the only thing that I that's dangerous is pre-production is important. And if you're going to, especially if you're approaching from a series, even if this module is only 2 minutes long, and I'm not trying to sell you on it at all, but just mentioning backstage or mentioning Craigslist as ways to get your actors, because you could show up on set with your camera. But if you don't have any actors, you know, you can't make your movie. So I would just, even if you want to briefly address it or, you know, or maybe shift it somewhere, but I would just say that.
Yeah, now I agree with you. I think it's all important. I think I want to wrap it maybe in a pre-production. At this point in time, what we've done is and maybe you do have it already in pre-production, and I'm just not realizing it, but we've kind of looked at filmmaking from the point of view of, you know, what does it mean to you? What do you want out of filmmaking? And here's a structure that we can work with that is existing, and if you are starting to get more serious, you can use. Now we're transitioning, and we're now looking at saying, okay, let's move forward of how we're going to do that. And so I think that moving forward from a big picture point of view is pre-production. So is that what you're showing me here, that we've got your equipment for pre-production? Okay.
So, and then this is not addressing, you know, the roles. Again, these are all broken down in a pretty organized way. This is not talking about the role of the director during pre-production. This is talking about, maybe equipment's the wrong word, maybe tools, because the tools that a first-time director can use during pre-production. Screenwriting software, crowdfunding websites.
But Mike, let me just ask you something. Before we can start, and maybe you addressed this, but I'm not clear on it right now, and that is, before I can talk about the tools, I need to talk about what pre-production is and the need for pre-production, don't you think?
We can shift this down, absolutely.
And I think I may, I'm recognizing that I may have been the one who put that in there, so I'm just, you know,
talking out loud. I moved things around a little bit, but you definitely had the discussion of the equipment coming right after the decision that the first-time film director is going to... So I kind of embrace that. But if you want to wrap... I mean, if we want to jump forward, let me just quickly jump forward.
Sure.
So coming into, so module three starts talking about the responsibilities of a film director, and then again, during the four stages of film directing, and then 4.0 is director's job during pre-production. So maybe under each of these modules, we then have a breakout and talk about the equipment for each of those modules, as opposed to having a discussion.
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. Yep. All right. Yeah, no, that makes sense. Almost kind of like a boop sidebar.
Yeah, that's actually a good way to look at it.
Okay. All right. No, that makes sense to me.
Let me anchor myself. So we go from the more serious. We looked at more fun, more serious. We go into the overview of what's coming up, and then what you're saying is now we're going to go to 3.0, and that is the responsibilities of the director, right?
Yeah. Yep. And it's one of those brief ones where 3.0 is just kind of introducing, in general terms, the responsibilities of a film director during the different stages of the film.
Got it. I love
it. And I think we could still keep our two roads running parallel of, and then besides these four roles, maybe the differences between the fun approach and the more serious approach during these four stages.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So, it fits. So now our structure is we're sticking with the film director, and now we're looking at they've made the choice to now start to embrace some of these processes. Here are what some of those processes, quote, responsibilities are. And as discussing, we can start to now look at them side by side with the more serious, the more fun. Mm-hmm. And then they can make a decision, and even within the more serious, the more fun, if you are thinking you're at the stage as a director and you're going to, I am going to make, this is a $10,000 short. I know it's only my second one, but I've got chops. I'm bringing people on board. I know what I want. I'm going serious. Or this is my third short, and I'm still having fun. And yeah, I still think I'm making a good film, but I'm not going to bring in $10,000 and go that serious. How can we find the balance for those two types of filmmakers in this scenario? And I think, we can, as you said, as long as we keep looking at, the juxtaposition of the serious and the fun next to each other.
Yeah, I like it.
Cool.
So moving forward, should we quickly go back and just look at the content of the equipment discussion and see if there's anything that we need to add or take out before we start shifting it into the stuff?
I think for our purposes here, I think I'm getting more out of looking at it from more of a big picture point of view.
Okay.
And knowing that we're going to be putting the equipment, down below and into these other modules, and we can decide later, because I'm really starting to grasp the whole flow of this thing now, and I'm liking the way it's going.
Okay. But
thanks for asking.
All right. Let me just put those aside. That's all the equipment discussion. All right, so let's just dig into 4.0 is, so this is starting to discuss the director's job or role during pre-production.
Okay.
I think it's important to let them know that your film success definitely starts in pre-production. You can't overlook it. It's one of the most important stages of the film, or of the filmmaking experience. And then also, you need a game plan. And one of the key things is, especially if you're going to approach it from both. This time is so precious to the director because, for the most part, you're not really wasting anyone's time.
Mm.
You're not wasting any money. It's you with a blank canvas, and there's something that can be very exhilarating about that.
Right.
So if you want me to get into the details here.
No, let's look at it from a big picture point of view for a second. And so what do you, so this is director pre-production, and you made a really good point in that this is, you know, I think how we want to stage this is from the point of view of, and you can, you know, anyway, how we want to stage this is that because you are really becoming intimate with your story, and you're doing this on your own time, every minute that you work, you are getting an exponential factor of benefit out of it, because you're now creating a plan that you can communicate to your tripod crew, and it also has a story impact, because this is where we start to do analysis and this type of stuff,
right,
that makes the vision of the director come through and show up in the performances and the backstory, not saying that the director comes up with backstory, and in what each shot should say. That's a collaboration with the cinematographer, but the director needs to know the point of view of the scene and where the story's going. And if you just arrive on set without having done this work, then you know, not only are you moving slower, but you're not anchored into that point of view and the intimacy of the story.
100% agree. And the phrase I had was, you can't wait for inspiration to hit you on set. You have to have a game plan. I have it written here, you know, M. Night Shyamalan, he made a great point. He's like, if you sit by yourself, draw your storyboards, do your script analysis, and you come to set with all that in hand, you at the very least know that that movie can be made and it's good to you. You know, you've done all the thinking and you haven't wasted a single cent of anyone's money or, you know, and anyone's time. You haven't wasted anything. You can make that movie.
Right.
And then if inspiration hits you on set, then it can only get better.
Right. Exactly. So. And I think that's, you know, that is, the beauty of that also is that you know if you are making a change on set, the ramifications of that change, because every change has a ramification. It's not obvious if you're not anchored into the intimacy of your story, and that is the only way I know that inspiration can affect you and not necessarily throw you off. Not to saying that it won't each and every time. David Fincher, I love what he said about this, and that is, I really don't know that much about making movies. He said, but what I do know about is I know how to direct a scene. This is a paraphrase. And so if you look at that, we can't necessarily predict the audience's point of view and all of those chain of effects, you know, of what's going to happen. You know, maybe Hitchcock could, maybe, you know, there's some that could, but Fincher is even recognizing, I know how to block a scene. I know how to create a point of view. I know how to bring all these things into it, but I can't, you know, I cannot predict everything, and so we need to do enough work so that we allow inspiration to take place on set and in the edit room.
Absolutely. You know, and the other thing is, I think you've experienced this before, and I've experienced this before, is the importance of pre-production when something goes wrong. So the importance of pre-visualization, you know, or when you have 10 people coming at you asking, you know, because every crew member will have their own agenda, so they're coming to you asking questions, and if you don't have this planned, if you don't have this on paper, even if you have it in your head or even if you know how to wing it on set, it just wastes time. So if you can hand someone a shot list or if you can hand someone a storyboard, it helps truncate the conversation, so then you can focus more on working with your actors and figuring out, you know, the story and staying on point. So
absolutely,
and again, and I think pre-production, it is so important, and you're not it's you in a room, blank canvas, and nothing can be more exciting about that, right? You know,
exactly. One of the things that I think maybe that I do want to remember to say as a bullet point, and that is athletes, we hear about athletes all the time. We take it for granted these days that they pre-visualize their performance. The ones who are really good, you know, maybe not every single one, but you hear it enough that it's pretty mainstream, that they are seeing themselves through. Who did I just hear about as an athlete that says, oh, I know who it was. It was Wilson, the quarterback. He said,
Russell Wilson, yeah.
Russell Wilson, I see the game in advance. I see this. And so there's energy, you know, tremendous amount of energy into pre-planning how all of this is going to go. No, they can't predict how every single person on that team, you know, the defense is going to move against them, but they have become so, it's almost like it's become slow motion. You see with a different set of eyes when you've done that kind of work, and that's why I like to call it pre-directing.
Yeah. Yep.
Cool.
So this is a pretty meaty module. So give me 30 seconds here, and I'll just quickly...
The one we're coming up to.
Well, no, this is pre-production. So this is a pretty meaty one, and we've addressed some of it, but we haven't addressed all of it. So let me just quickly give you the bullet points. Okay. So you have... Let me just see something for 1 second, John.
Yep.
If I can... This might be really handy. I don't know if this happens live. Let me see if that happens live.
Oh, the yellow shows up, yeah.
Did it show up? Okay.
Shows up on my end, storyboard, all right. Yeah.
All right, cool. So you have storyboard, and I kind of go through, you know, some ways you can approach storyboard. Script analysis and identifying the beats.
Yep.
That's very important. I think that's something we can discuss during this module.
Totally agree.
Cut out the fat. You know, that doesn't any scene that doesn't propel your story.
Yep.
This was an important one we discussed the other day, John. So even if you wrote your script, like most new filmmakers do, film directors do. It's really important to move from falling in love with your words and then how you're going to adapt that as a director. So you have to
again, underneath this pre-production phase, these are the things, this is the process, the things that are going to come up, the time that you want to take during this phase. So, yep, I agree. Yep.
Whatever money you're going to need during your film, you're going to need to... You're going to need to get the money, okay?
And this may be another opportunity for us to now look at that tripod approach and look at the job of the producer. You know, if you're still writing and you're doing things and, you know, and somebody's got to be out raising money, you know, there's
absolutely.
It's almost impossible, you know, for one person to be doing all of this if you're trying to move at any kind of a pace.
Yep.
Momentum.
You know, and then a couple other tidbits I had here were, you know, it's the Robert Rodriguez approach, the way he made El Mariachi. He had zero money, he had $0, and he just kind of made a laundry list of all the assets that he had access to. So he had a bus, he had some guns, he had an abandoned building, and then he wrote the screenplay around that. So it's instant production value.
Let me ask you a question here. So I totally love Robert Rodriguez, and I love that his story is inspirational. I do think it should be in here. I just wonder if this is the place for it. At this point, if I'm anchored correctly, we are talking about the importance of certain processes during pre-production, and so I'm not quite connecting with how Rodriguez fits into this here.
Because you need a script. So script happens in the pre-production stage, correct?
Correct.
So I don't know if you want to branch out into another module, but I think you have to address if you are. Perfect example is, let's say you're not a writer, but you want to be a director. How do you quickly come up with your 10-minute story? You know, look around, see you have access to something that's different than most short films that are made today. So.
Yeah, no, I totally agree with you. Maybe we should just look at the possibility and revisit this that maybe we bring him in because he's such an inspirational story, and I think that that is such a great example of how you can be start to get serious and still have fun and use this minimal approach that Rodriguez, you know, has used. I wonder if this module, if we ought to assume that the screenplay has been done, because we're not getting into talking about, I don't think we are talking about the writing of a screenplay. I don't know that I want to. It's not my expertise.
Here's where this came in for my flow. So if you're putting on the director cap, let me just call this up. So if you're putting on the director cap, let's just assume that the screenplay is already written. Okay? You either wrote it, or your friend wrote it, or, you know, you purchased it, you know, and you want to make this as your film. One of the things that I said is, as you're doing your script analysis, find opportunities to maybe play certain scenes in different locations. So instead of shooting in your living room, take the Rodriguez approach, and if you have access to a horse track, try to see if that scene that was going to take place in the living room or a dorm room, put it in front of the ponies at the horse track, and it just gives your film instant production value.
All right. I'm totally with you. So let me tell you my interpretation of that.
Sure.
That is, so what you're saying is that there is a time in this is in this pre-production stage that, like with analysis, you want to step back from what was written on the page, and you want to look at it from a different point of view, because now you're the director. And part of a director's job is to bring production value and to bring mood and to bring in other characters, meaning locations. So stop and reflect, even if you have no money, stop and reflect on what you can bring to it. And this is the stage to do that in. And our example is Robert Rodriguez. Totally with you.
Yeah.
Told me again.
So, man, if I can monetize that selling, that'd be great. So, all right, and then the other things, again, and there's some, and I've even addressed it here. Let me just call this up. This is the last little bit of this module. And I'm, again, we're going overview right now.
Yep.
So again, schedule.
What we're going to do is we'll wrap it up, you know, here pretty soon, and then we'll pick up again that, you know,
sure,
another recording, because at this point I think, you know, so we'll finish this, you know, this pre-production out so that we can wrap it up nice and tight.
Okay. So so we have schedule, but again, like I said, it's usually the role of the producer. But you know, the
let me just jump in there for a second just to keep myself straight.
Sure.
So it's usually, so I think what we want to be careful of is we want to make sure that, because you're right, it's usually the role of the producer and sometimes the director does it, but I'm going to start using the language of, you know, this is the role of the producer. So when you're doing this, if you're the director, guess what? You've now got the producer hat on.
Well, and that's kind of what we had already kind of addressed is especially in this early stage, is gestation stage, you may be wearing multiple hats, but you want to just, if you want to learn how to direct, you want to identify when you're not just directing and you're wearing another hat.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Right. And I think that goes back to the tripod approach. So the fact that we've introduced that early on, we're going to be able to reflect back to that and start to point out these times when people are putting the, you know, the hats on, when the director has now become the director and the producer and, you know, the cinematographer or whatever.
Yep. So the same thing goes in line with, you know, the same thing. Let's see. So we got, you know, location scouting, obviously. Same thing. Usually the role of the producer. Procuring funding. You know, usually the producer will tackle this task.
Well, and yes, you're right. The location scouting is definitely a three-part
right
job. The producer is in charge of, you know, acquiring and doing the paperwork, but certainly the director and the cinematographer are, you know, very much involved with deciding on what locations get done or scouting to. Cool.
And then I guess the biggest thing to take away from the pre-production is being prepared and have, you know, having a point of view.
Yeah. So. Yep. Absolutely.
So I don't know if you want to wrap it up now. I mean, I go through a little bit more detail of 4.1 is script analysis, 4.2 is creating your shooting plan. So, and then obviously I think a 4.3 would be talking about the equipment for pre-production if we're going to move.
You know what? Do just what you're doing right now. Let's take, you know, 2 minutes and give us an overview of what's, you know, what we're going to be looking at next. That'll be a good way for me to start, you know, getting steeped and anchor myself in it. Okay, so we've been in pre-production. We've set up the role of the producer. You've introduced Rodriguez and the concept of, you know, getting your, you know, more production value out of your locations. Okay, the viewer's getting excited. They're thinking, geez, I can do this. You know, this is a structure. I can learn this. All right, so I'm anchored. Let's move forward.
Okay. And then maybe branching out, either we keep them in the previous module or we branch out and just get a little bit more detailed in terms of what exactly a script analysis is. It's your job as a director to interpret the script and make it your own. So again, uncovering subtext. The subjective and the objective, identifying, you know, all the things. If you want to get a little bit more detailed, and I know this is an overview course, just a little bit more detail, just a little tidbits about, you know, what a script analysis actually entails.
Yep.
We can do it, and then...
Let's try to wrap this whole thing up. Sure. Okay. So then where do we go? We go from script analysis to creating a shooting plan.
So it's a little bit more details, you know, of lining your script, naming your shots, and basically getting the basic coverage of each scene. In pre-production during the shooting plan, you should always have a B, you know, if you're planning on shooting outside, and then you show up and it rains, you know, make sure you have your B location.
I think we need to just go over the actual modules, Mike. We got to wrap this up in like a couple minutes, and I think we're only halfway through. So, yeah, let's just look at these... like creating a shooting plan.
So creating a shooting plan, and then let's just make sure. Wow, I have a lot in here, and we should definitely wrap this up because I have a lot in here, and we're probably going to have to work on the structure of this. I don't necessarily know if you're going to want to have the breakdowns of the roles of each department before you start getting into the responsibilities of the director during production.
But all I want to do right now is just let's roll through it. Let's just read it.
Sure.
Just the module.
So 4.2 is you're creating a shooting plan. 4.3 would probably be the discussion of the equipment. Move that to there.
The way we have it now, so this is why we're doing this, is we're really figuring out, you know, how this flow is. And this is the first time we're really stepping back and looking at it. So the way we have it now, communicating your vision,
Communicating your vision, and that's to all the departments of your production, and then that's where that would branch off to basically discussing and giving an overview of each department. So 5.1 would be the camera department, 5.2 would be the lighting department, 5.3 would be the production department, 5.4 would be, if you're so lucky, hair, wardrobe, and makeup. That's a luxury. 5.5 would be your sound. And before I move on, and I know you want an overview, if you can't capture good sound, make your film a silent movie.
Not a luxury.
It's not a luxury. It's the most underrated, that and good acting, most underrated part of your production. So 6.0 is the responsibilities of a film director while on set during production.
Yep.
6.1 would be about directing performance, a very important one. Become familiar with the different methods of acting and just the way you should deal with your actors. 6.2 is about directing plot and story. And that's both through... We won't get into the details there. 6.3, making your day.
Yep.
There's nothing worse than feeling that tick, tick, tick.
Especially if you've got a somebody funding your film.
Yep. And that's where compromise comes into play. You have to drop shots, and you have to be willing to drop shots. 7.0 would be the responsibilities of a film director during post-production, working with your editor, et cetera, et cetera. 7.1 would be music. A lot of people overlook this and think they can just go grab their John Williams CD off their shelf and put the music into the film. Can't do that if you want it to actually be seen. You need the rights. 8.0 is the responsibilities of the film director during what I call the post-post-production, or getting your film out there and seen. So all the roles of the director of getting your film out. And this, again, you sometimes will work with the producer on that. 9.0 would be taking all this and going, if you can't make a narrative film, a fictional film, you can consider the avenue of documentary. It's a great way to get your foot in the door. And then 10 would be, after now you've taken these first steps, you should start thinking about taking your next step as a filmmaker and making that step count. So that's a quick overview of the rest.
Excellent. And so something that we can think about before we, you know, talk about it again is maybe maybe the documentary thing, maybe we bring that up early on. And because there is times that the documentary filmmaking where we do, you know, there's a lot of pre-production. Yes, pre-production is different and things that may be. But anyway, I just want to consider it. That's all.
Well, and it's one of those, a point I made in that section is that it's a great affordable way to learn some of the principal ideas of fiction filmmaking. Storytelling, camera use, you know, working with exterior light, interior light, you know, and you can have a much smaller crew still tell a story, you know, and all the way through post-production of working with your editor. It's a great way to learn filmmaking usually on a smaller budget.
Right. And I mean, it definitely can be on a smaller budget, and you can definitely have an interesting story because your characters are real people. And, you know, there's people like Roger Deakins who, you know, has shot, you know, many films for some, you know, Coen Brothers, and I forget his most recent film that he just did. And he came from the documentary world. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot to be said for that.
Yeah, Deakins. Well,
you know, I'm looking at this and I'm going, isn't it interesting? You know, I thought this whole thing was going to be much smaller than it is, and it is small from the point of view is that it's, you know, it's going to be interview style, but it's you know, if we're really looking at working with beginning directors and putting together a foundation of success for them, regardless of exactly where they want to go, I think we're hitting it. I think we've got the stuff that you know, should be in here.
You know, and it's like you have to decide what approach you want to take. If you want to make it three separate courses, you know, in terms of, or four separate courses, mm-hmm. in terms of pre-production, production, post. If you want to make it one whole overview where you really try to stick to nuggets of information that a first-time filmmaker can just absorb, you know, quick things and not go into detail. Or you just make it huge and long and 8 hours. Yeah, I don't know. What I tried to give to you was give you as much information and you can then zig or zag accordingly.
You know? All right, here's something that I'll ask you. And it doesn't have to be done right now, but within the next few weeks. So as an editor, someone that has done, you know, documentaries, long form, lots of corporate, you've done advertising, you've done short film. What I'd like you to do, if you could, is try to do some projections about, you know, how much footage do you think we're going to create during these questions. Now, I know that's up to me and how I answer, but this is the kind of stuff that we have to deal with when we're doing, you know, the types of work that you and I have been doing a lot of, and making some projections also about how much time do you think, you know, based on getting this amount of footage. So let's say we shoot 13 hours worth of footage in these interviews. how much time do you think it's going to take to break that down and to make that first content cut within a range? And then how much time do you think, you know, it's going to take to now bring the B-roll and that kind of stuff to it within a range? Because one of the decisions I've got to make is just what you're saying. What shape should this take? You know, if this turns out to be a two-month period, you know, then maybe I've got to make something smaller first before I go down that path.
Yeah, I don't... I'll embrace what you said, and I don't have the answer right now because you really, it's a math game. But the one thing that I would say to you is I think you have to decide whether you want there to be more B-roll or if you just want to embrace you on camera, content, two-camera shoot, cut, and just get the content out as opposed to...
I totally agree, but I think that decision can also be affected by how long we think it's going to take to cut the A content roll. You know, like if I thought we could cut A content roll in 2 weeks, you know, and then I could do my, you know, then I'd say, geez, maybe at that point I may say I'm going to do enough B roll so that I can get it done in 2 weeks, and so I might gauge myself with loosely, you know, with some of those factors. If I thought it was going to take 2 months to do my A-roll, then I think I would say what you're saying is, maybe, you know what, I either got to create a different course or I can't make, you know, I can only do A-roll.
No, here's what I would say to you, and don't hold me to this, what I would say to you is, just as we were just discussing, I think if we spend a little bit extra time in pre-production and do a paper edit, and we streamline exactly what information you want to hit and what information you don't want to hit, and we cut it out before we get in front of the camera, I think that would save us so much time during the A cut. You know, as opposed to you sitting down, shooting 15 hours of stuff, and then trying to figure out what our best 4 hours of stuff is. If we've done this, we have decades of experience. If we sit down and really figure out exactly what content we want to communicate to the student, I think that would save us a lot of time in the edit.
Well, there's no doubt. I mean, that goes without a doubt.
Yeah.
But here's the thing with that, too, is that is a discretionary. You know, what do we cut out, what do we cut in? And that discretionary is based on what do we want to make. Is this
right
a course that is really going to be, you know, a very thorough foundation course, you know, and even those words need to be more. Is this something that is going to give, you know, a real blueprint for people to go out and make their first three films? Or, and I think where I started with this, is this an overview that is just going to introduce people to the processes of the filmmaking machine, of the process, so that they can decide whether they want to investigate any further. And that's what I think you're saying the same thing.
Yeah, and I think you have you could make two courses out of this.
Right.
You know, the 60-minute overview course, and then the 8-hour detailed specific course. And I think it could be from the same script.
Right. And, you know, maybe that's a good way to look at it, is to say, how long do I want this course to be? And I'll tell you, for the introductory course, something that, you know, is going to be very inexpensive, I don't want it to be 8 hours.
Yeah, no, I agree. I agree.
I think you know, I'm leaning more toward doing something much smaller and doing this, but doing it afterward. How about we do this? I think maybe the next step is, you know, since you're steeped in it, and this is a difficult part of the process, but cut this down on paper to an hour course, to an hour overview.
Okay. I could take a couple hours and do that.
I have no idea. We don't know what that's going to be, but you know, let's use that as our guide and see if we really like anything. Let's see if we like it at the end after we cut this down to an introductory course and we make it, you know, for that brandy new person. Because matter of fact, I just got a LinkedIn question from a person, and as you know, Twitter's been on fire, and I've got a guy on Twitter who are asking very similar things, and that is, how do we get started?
Yeah.
And I, you know, I don't want to give them an eight-hour course. I want to give them something free, or I want to give them, you know, a $20, you know, a $30 course that tells them what these next steps are so that they go, oh, cool. You know, like you said, that this is the kind of thing that even the fun filmmaker looks at when they get into what the more serious is about and goes, geez, I think I could do this.
Well, then my two comments to that are, I think you want to make that 60 minutes feel like it's jam-packed with nuggets. Like, and maybe it's you might have to rein in some of your long-winded answers.
Absolutely.
Shoot it.
What are you trying to say there?
I love you. We're both a wealth of knowledge. So, if we were just to approach it like it's going to be, you know, like just 4 hours of stuff just packed in. So maybe they don't get it all right away, but they're like, oh, I got to watch it again. Oh, what was that part? What was that part? What was that part? And they just start watching it over and over and over again to try to pick up some of the stuff. And maybe we have impact text to help highlight some of that stuff and just embrace you maybe against white and bounce you around the screen, impact text, hitting home the stuff, and just go through it. Just go through it and go, this is, you know, DSLR versus HD. Do-do-do-do-do. You know, quickly give like two or three reasons, not 10 reasons, why you would use one or the other. You know, the idea of having maybe one good lens that helps you out.
I don't know. See, I...
Because I think
I don't want to get into DSLR versus that, because I think that's all over the web. They already know that, don't they? I mean, I want to get into here's what I don't think they know about. They don't know about camera blocking. They don't know about script analysis. Right. They don't know about the tripod.
It was a horrible example, and I'm sorry. You on that. No, it was a horrible. I just used that because it happened to be the one thing that was sitting in front of me.
Right. Sorry.
What I will say is, whatever we do, as opposed to giving long-winded answers and flesh out the 10 reasons why you would use, why you'd block it this way or this way, just try to quickly hit some of the key principles. You know, like, I think...
Point made. No, I understand what you're saying.
I think... I think what we're doing is curating all the information that's out there and trying to put it in a streamlined form. Right. So I think...
But let me say something, Mike. Here's what I want to... And I think we're on the same page here, is I think this next cut, you know, has to not be, no, we can't go into long-winded answers on them. I think we need to make serious cuts, like maybe full modules or big parts of modules need to get cut out of this.
Yep.
Not that it's not valuable, but I just think...
No, I agree.
We have to do major
for
cuts.
Let's say for this 60-minute version. Yep. 100% agree.
And you know what? I'll revisit it because I think... you know, because I'll have some strong opinions on it, and I gave you the first structure, I don't think it's fair for me to leave it all on you unless you want that first cut. Do you want me to maybe highlight what I think are the most important modules or give you...
It's whatever you think is most efficient. Seriously.
Okay. So you don't care either way because I could go either way also. Okay.
Yeah, I'm willing to do whatever. Again, to play devil's advocate, the only thing that I will say is I don't think if you're going to do a 60-minute overview, you can get into the details of camera blocking either. You know, I think you have to just give the basic gist. You know, and maybe there's a creative way. I'm just, again, don't shoot the messenger. I'm just bringing this up. So let's say we're going to quickly just bring up the idea of the 180 line, just quickly, okay? But maybe there's a way to rat-tat-tat it and bring up the 180 line, say one or two things, boom, boom, show a picture on set, on screen. This works. See how this doesn't work. Boom, 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 and then move on to another topic. As opposed to having a four-minute discussion about the 180 line.
Mike, you're absolutely right, because here's what this is, and I think this is a good way to frame it. This is, I got invited to do a presentation for beginning filmmakers to a college, and I've got 60 minutes. And so, what can I say about the camera blocking module? I can introduce the concepts, I can introduce the importance of it, and then I can share one thing. Maybe it's the 180, maybe it's the moving 180 line, and probably it's all wrapped up in the fact that it's about screen geography. Because really, if we ask ourselves, why is this stuff important, that's really where our answers come from. And the reason that it's important is because we have to keep screen direction, we have to keep the viewer oriented. And if they get it done, if they continue to be disoriented enough, they're going to lose themselves in the story. And so that is really, if we just do an overview, that's almost all that we have to sell in that module. And I think it really is a sell, because we're not selling them on the course, we're selling them on why this part of the craft is important. Because, and give them a nugget, and then you use the word nugget, give them a nugget of information so that they go, oh, and we wrap it up by saying, and that's just the tip of it, or something like that.
Well, and let's use the conversation about Rodriguez just for a second, okay? So yep. instead of, because he's not the only one that's done it, I just use him as an example. Everybody does it. When you put on your director cap and you're looking at the screenplay, you're trying to come up with creative ways to, creative places to stage that stuff, new ways to look at it. So instead of going through a whole discussion about why Rodriguez did that, et cetera, if you're going to do a quick overview of script analysis, say, hey, maybe you can, if you have access to a horse track, take that scene that was at the living room, put it to horse track. Instant production value. Boom. Then you move on to the next topic. Do you know what I'm saying? As opposed to going into a four-minute discussion about why that gives your film instant production value. Or, you know what I'm saying? Try to come up with creative ways. If you and your friends are all in your dorm room, try to make your movie not in your dorm room. Because everyone is making a movie in their dorm room. That kind of stuff. Just quick things and move on.
And, and I think, and maybe, oddly enough, maybe the structure does kind of come out of, like the Rodriguez method, or we look at a couple filmmakers to give us that through line that says, this is a similar model that we're going to be sharing with you, and here's what he did, and here's where it fits into this model. Because as I'm thinking about it, right off the bat, if I had to cut something or cut it way, way down, one of them would be everybody can make a movie. Okay, that's a given. We're not here if we didn't know that already,
Right there, hold on. No. You don't just cut it out completely. You do the 10 seconds you just did.
There you go.
Like,
yep. Yep. All right, everybody, so there you go. So all right, so module one is everybody can make a movie. Guys, at this point, we all know that we can make movies. We've got DSLRs. We've got the computers. We've got everything we need to make a movie. The question is, can we make a good movie? And that's what we're going to move on to next. How serious are you about being a filmmaker? Do you want to make a film just to have fun and to be able to show it to your neighbors and the folks here? Well, this process is going to help you with that also. But if you want to get more serious, then we're going to show you the structures that exist within the filmmaking machine that is already being used in Hollywood, is being used in corporate, and is being used in advertising. That's what we're going to share here. Let's get into it. And so that's the kind of thing you're saying is, let's hit the highlights so that I have to, and maybe, the thing that I'm wondering is, does that feel, like that felt right now like it was more of a straight-to-camera kind of thing where that's scripted, or, I guess it's not scripted. I could work from an outline and wing it. Or is it, you know, interview style, which seems to be a little more laid back?
Yeah, maybe the interview style is more for the fleshed out 8-hour one, you know, or 6-hour one, or whatever it is, you know. Maybe it is just, you know, and again, I'm just thinking, I'm not saying this even has to stay in. So again, don't kill me. But like, let's say we were going to go, should you go to film school or not? Right? And on screen, you see 15 names come up on screen. If they didn't go to film school, you don't have to. Then move on, or, you know, whatever. Like, you can get across information very quickly and then just keep moving forward. And then maybe you do slow down a little bit on some of the more technical stuff. You know, so you're not cutting out content completely, but you're just, again, and I'm not selling you on keeping the to-go or not to-go in. I'm just saying that's just an example of a way to get a lot of information across in a nanosecond.
Yeah, no, and don't ever hesitate on, you know, trying to sell something. I think that the best product, you know, the best things come out of people having strong opinions and then compromising in the end. You know, that's what it's all about. Yeah, so we got a lot to think about. You know, it's so interesting. I wish this, you know, in some ways I really wish this was easy. But I'm now thinking, I've we gotta keep thrashing. We gotta keep thrashing and keep cutting.
I think it's all here. I think whatever we decide to do, you know, whatever we decide to do is here. So we just now, we just kind of pull from this, or, you know, I just keep going back. There's certain things that scare me because I want to cut a lot out. I totally am willing to cut out a lot, but I also think there are certain things that maybe you're not as embracing as much as I am. You know, I do still think there is ingrained in some people, I didn't go to school, I can't make a movie. You know what I'm saying? So, like, if you put up a bullet list, Kubrick, Hitchcock, Spielberg, Cameron, Gilliam, Nolan, Jackson, Ridley Scott, Richard Linklater, Quentin Tarantino, David Fincher, all didn't go to film school. You can make it. Follow along. You know, I think those little things help give that encouragement to that budding wannabe film director.
All right. You know? My mind is made up. So I'm going to stay out of it. So I'm going to let you create the 60-minute version. Because I like what you're saying.
Okay, I'll do it. But I'll do it quickly. So then you, I won't get bogged down in the details and wordsmithing. I will just
bullet points.
Bullet points. Okay.
Right. All right. I mean, and so let's say this. So, you know, I think we had to get into, as you said, some jumping off point scripting during this process, but you know, for this next one, just bullet points.
Okay. All right.
And yes, because I'm going to have to, it'll be something that I'll have to understand, and we're going to go, you know, straight to camera, maybe for all of this. And some of it's going to be handled like you just described in quick bullet points. And so the whole idea, you know, instead of giving them a thorough foundation, is going to give them a true insight as to what to help them decide what they want out of filmmaking and what is their next step.
Right.
If that's all we do, then that's great, because we can follow up with documents and anything else or another course.
And two other things to think about. We may find that maybe we, you know, maybe it's something. I'm gonna hold that thought. I'm just gonna hold that thought.
Okay.
All right. So, what I would say is, if you're going to embrace the straight to camera, and it's gonna be bullet point, either we come up with a script, we quickly come up with a script, and you can deviate somewhat or whatever. But I think if we embrace impact text, quick shots of pictures, that can mask edits that we might need to make, as opposed to having a two camera setup where we were going to use both cameras to cut to. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. I got to revisit this, Mike. I totally know what you're saying. I totally agree with you. And here's what I can't have happen. Or I have to ask you this. So we started off working on, you know, direct with us, and I keep coming back and saying I need a beginner course. And I keep coming back to it, and I just can't seem to create a course that is something that we can pull off in a month.
I think we can totally do this in a month.
Okay. All right.
I'm thinking,
and that's valuable too. I'm not saying we just do it in a month, but something that's valuable to the first-time filmmaker. Oh. What's going to happen is I got to get back to work, and I'm gonna, you know, I'm gonna run out of money on this project, and I got to get something done.
You know, we both watched that other course the other day, and it was just, and that was punching in on one camera. There wasn't even two cameras. It was just a gentleman sitting in front of the desk, you know.
He was doing straight to camera, right? Yeah, he was doing straight to camera,
but they were just, I don't know if they shot 4K or whatever. They were just, you know, they were just reframing the same shot. A little slow, a little clunky, but
yeah,
it seemed...
No, I agree. He was not the best presenter.
No, but I mean, he still is attracting some students. We can embrace it that way, but I'm just saying, without too much more work, if we came across some kind of graphic design, some simple impact text graphic design, you could cut in and out and just show bullet points, boom, 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 you know, like that, and then come back to you. I don't think you have to worry about massaging B-roll or doing whatever. I just think, like, a quick hitter, I think, doesn't take that much more time, and I think you'd be able to get more content into the piece. But you think about it, you thrash it around.
Well, I think either way, I don't think I need to make a decision, you know, like tonight on whether it's straight to camera or not. I think the major decisions are what you know we're saying, and just to reiterate, is we've got to cut chunks out, and I've got to figure out ways to say them as overviews.
Yeah, and just to give you peace of mind, if you're asking me as the editor, I can totally see this thing being done quick. You know, quickly. You know, I really do. So I just, you know, it's not going to be massaged edits and match cuts and all that stuff. It's going to be, boom, here is a download of 60 minutes of my knowledge. You know, boom, you can make a movie. That's, I can see it happening. So let's,
And maybe that's the title, you know, maybe this isn't First Steps. Maybe the thing that we were just looking at was First Steps, and maybe this title of this thing is You Can Make a Movie.
Yeah. Because the other thing is, I know you want a streamlined product to get out there. I think this can be it. And I think either we then readdress and maybe do the longer version, and maybe we'll discuss it another time.
All right, man. I'm going to sign out on this broadcast and come back. But this is, you know, what's cool about this is stick around, Mike. I'll just sign off and we'll chat and set up for the next time. But I just want to let anybody that might still be watching this to know that this is the real stuff that happens. The way that I'm working with Mike right now, you know, I have to admit, you know, not to admit, you know, it's part of the process. You know, we're creating something. We're figuring it out what we're doing. And there's always change. You know, every project that I've done, whether it's a four-minute video or a large piece, has always had this process of, you know, what is it? And reshaping and, you know, and then it goes through that same process in the edit room. So, that's why we're sharing it.
Well, and keep in mind that this is all information that's in both of our heads. You know, we're just trying to figure out the best way to tell it. That's a lot like a lot of people out there that have those movies in their heads. They just have to figure out how to tell it. So it's very much the same process.
That's exactly it. That's why we're sharing it.